Shamah Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Shamah Yisrayah. You're listening to Shamah Yisrayah with Raah Dawid Shamah sitting here live on this precious Shabbatont. As we have gathered our minds, our substance, our desires, and our passion as we face toward Yerushalayim, as we gather in the Ohel, the congregation of Almighty Yahweh and Yahshua, the very triumphant entrance, Yahshua HaMashiach, as he enters into the Beit, as his Torah enter into your mind, we prepare ourselves for this Shabbatont, this time of rest in Yahshua HaMashiach. Shalom Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Yisrayah, sitting here live on this precious Shabbatont that Yah has granted unto his nation, the sign between he and his people, that we rest on the Shabbat. It is a Shabbatont unto the nation of Yisrayah, those that he has elected according to his purpose, and those that are of the Zerah, the seed of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, as the promises, as we see the light and the bearing of that promise and the promises of Abraham in our precious Yaakov Yisrael. We greet you all in Yahshua's mighty name. We do hope that you have enjoyed the blessings of Yah on these past days until this Shabbat. To be alive is worth more than one could ask for, to be cognate and conscious of the purpose of Yah, and above all, to be in some stableness of health. What a great blessing that is Yisrayah. You're listening to Shamah Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Yisrayah, sitting here live on this Shabbatont. I'm here for your questions, your calls. We're going to have a great Shabbat Yisrayah. As I sent out a newsletter, email, concerning what I wanted to talk on tonight, the telephone line is open. You may call. You can be inquisitive. You have questions. You have comments. You're free to call. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. I do want to teach on a specific tonight, but do not think that you will interfere if you call. I want your calls. We want the response from Yisrayah, because there is much folly that is taking place. There is much folly among the nation of Yisrayah, and we have many that are deceivers. Shaul talks, Hifa talks about how that many in the hour that we are in, he uses the word natta. He said they would retch, they would bend, they would twist, they would alter through a convoluted concept of their own vile mind. He said that many, because they do not understand, because these are unlearned men and women, they don't understand things because it's difficult for them to understand. They are people that are unlearned, and not only that, they are unstable, so they wrestle. They bend, they turn, they twist, they alter the kitzvah of Yah, the scriptures of Yah, the wisdom and the knowledge of Yah, to what? To their own shamath, their own destruction, their own death. And we find that today, Yisrayah. That's why Hepha, as he wrote unto the scattered house of Yisrayah, scattered abroad. He said, there are those that are speaking things that they don't even understand what they are speaking. There are things that they think they have the knowledge of it, and they have no wisdom of that at all, Yisrayah. And so what they do, they bend, they twist, they alter the Torah, because they are unstable men to their own destruction. And that is present today, that these, I call them Naha, these young boys, that's all they are. They have no wisdom. They think because they resonate a loud voice of ignorance. And of course, first of all, they always go to their little orchestrated type construct, just like the Jehovah Witnesses, just like the Mormons, and they cannot go outside of the paradigm of what they have been rigidly instructed in. I teach you the Torah of Yah. I teach you truth. It is one thing that Yah commanded Yisrayah, that they should not nata, they should not retch, they should not twist or bend, they should not turn or alter. He said his mishpat, his judgment. That's what Yah says to us. And in essence, we should not have any respect of person. Neither shall we allow one to give us a gift, because it is the gift of corruption that does blind the eyes, the ayin, the spiritual perception and knowledge of the wise. That's what it does, Yisrayah. And when one's ayin is altered, or they have rash judgment, then there is a perverted words that proceeds from them that is not of Almighty Yahweh. And so I want to teach tonight. I want your calls. I want to interact with you. I want to hear from those that will debate me on this matter. And it is one thing that we must learn, Yisrayah, the linguists or language linguistics. It is a combination of word, words, synonyms, antonyms, prefix, suffix, that defines or give a definitive of the nature of what is being described. You cannot say the word T-W-O means the same thing as a preposition. It doesn't imply. And so you cannot associate your definition to a word through its origins, its etymology, and you're going to define it in your unlearned, ignorant manner. It's not of Yah. And so what Yah does, he gives us a Hebraic knowledge of things through Torah, that it doesn't take much to understand the Hebraic roots of his words. Shalom, who's calling? Where are you calling from? Shabbat Shalom, who's calling?
Shabbat Shalom, Pastor, this is Sister Diane.
How are you this beautiful Shabbat?
I'm tough.
Beautiful.
I just wanted you to speak on this, speaking of folly and deceivers.
Yes.
I was here in my hometown, and there's this newspaper that comes out in the neighborhood, and they took out a quarter page ad, and it says Yahweh, and it says www.yahwehbenyahweh.com.
Yes.
So I just want you to speak on that a little bit, because that is definitely deceiving and folly and all of that.
Well, you know, let me say this, that Yah is the one of delusion and deception. Can I show you something? Let me read this. I want to teach on a specific matter tonight too, but that's all right. I like that. Let me show you something here. All right.
Okay.
Let me show you something. This is what the Torah says. I want to show you is because we must understand that Yah is doing everything that is being done, okay? It's not in the hands of the enemy, but it is Yah. I want to show you something here in Torah. It says this in 2 Thessalonians. All right, Shaul writes unto the elect of Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians. It says this here. It talks about, in 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 9, he talks about this anti-Hamashiach, this one that works with great power granted unto him by Yah. He said, even him whose coming is after the working of Hashatan. Now listen to what he says. He says, coming with all koach. He's coming with not the mufith of Yah. I like to use the Greek analogy for that signs, Zimeon. He's coming with signs and powerful lying, shekhah, miracles. You see that? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 9. That's how the operation of Hashatan, the power of his manifesto, it comes in this dimension. It says in verse 10, not only will he come with that power, but he's going to have this power of deceit. He says, and with all deceivableness and evil unrighteousness, in who? In them that perish. Because, this is it, my Echot, because they receive not the love of Torah, of truth, that they might be delivered. Well, why shall this happen? Well, verse 11 shows us. It says, because they did not receive the love of Torah, not that they love Torah, they did not accept the love or the power of Torah to operate in them, to show them the power of the Most High, Almighty Yahweh. He said, and for this cause, Yah, Almighty Yahweh, shall send strong, damnable delusion. That's what it says. Yah will send strong delusions for what? That they should believe a lie. So he wants them to believe Yahweh ben Yahweh. He sent that delusion, Ahot. He sent that delusion. He wants the people to buy that. That he might. And then he says this in verse 12. Yah sends this delusion that they should believe a lie. Why would you do that, Yah? That they all might be damned who believe not the truth. What is truth? Psalms, Tehillim, 119, 142 tell you what truth is. It's Torah. That they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in Yahweh ben Yahweh and the deceivers like T.D. Jakes and the liars and mama's religion and daddy's religion, kinsman religion. Yah sends the delusion. So when we see that, let us not be afraid or perturbed. Let's rejoice in all things we should give to that. He gives life. He calls life to come. Doesn't Yah cause that?
That's right.
He's the one that gives life, doesn't he?
Yes.
And he also kills too. He's the one that kills. No, it's not the devil that kills. It's Yah, Almighty Yahweh. And what we have done by this Christian lie, we have been indoctrinated to think, oh, the devil did that. No, Yah said, I will send the strong delusions that they all might believe that they should believe a lie. That they should believe a lie. That's what it says in 2 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 11. You're going to do that, Yah? That they all might be damned. He has sent the false, the Christos of the Messiahs, not the Hamashiach. This anti-spirit that draws attention to man and not to Almighty Yahweh, it is a damnable lie. And they create these images and they create this kind of awe of a man. Damn this wicked flesh. And so anytime a man seduces the minds of the people, whereby they cannot see the power of Yah, when his wickedness is not revealed. There used to be a man that called me, he was a member of Yahweh ben Yahweh. And I told him to get rid of him. I said, send me an offering. Oh, I can't do that. He would always call me and ask questions. He said, what do you think about Yahweh? I say, he's going to die and he's going to hell. That's what I think. That's what, oh, no, no, he's not going to die. So I tell you what, when he dies, I want you to call me. He died too. So Yah's doing that. So just rejoice in it. Let them write that. Say, ah, my Abba. Ah, what a beautiful thing. I appreciate you doing that. What a great thing that you have done. Yah is the one that sent these delusions. And it is one thing that we must understand or hold that this folly that is wrought among Yisrael, whereby this dishonor, it is called Nebelah. It is a dishonor whereby it is almost like a man laying, doing something that is so immoral and so profane. His actions are so vile. That's what folly is. It is one of the most detestable things, Holtz. It is a vile thing. It is a vile thing. It is an error of no fear of Almighty Yah. You just don't participate in them. Let them do their folly. You can't convince them. Let you just be convinced that is folly. And let them go on.
Okay. That's how you do that. You would answer it good for me. So.
Yeah. Don't allow that to trouble you, Ahud. You can't allow. Come on. You know, a young man called me the other day, and I want to teach a little bit tonight, but I want the cause, Yisrael. You listen to Shema Yisrael. And he calls me the other day. He was so excited. Raah Dawid Shamah Yisrayah. Oh, my. He said, I have this sight. I said, yes. I was tired. I had worked hard. And he said, I have this sight for you. I said, you do. I said, what about it? It is so full of knowledge, so enriching. I say, where or what is the site? He says, it's about the New World Order and the Illuminati. I say, damn the New World Order, damn the Illuminati. And I began to rebuke him. I say, here you are. You get excited more about some damn secretive organization. It can't be that secret when you know about it. I say, don't waste my time with that man. I'm telling you, do not waste my time, my energy. Don't waste it with that. Here you are so damn fearful of some damn secret organization that Yah has raised them up. And if Yah be for us, who can be against us? I say, man, when I finished with the young man, I said, young man, I knew about that before you were born. He says to me, you're right. I understand, Raah. I knew you would bring it out right to me. So I reproved him hard for that. Don't call me with no mess like that. I'm not concerned about New World Order. Yahshua wasn't concerned with that. He was concerned with the house of Yisrael to show us our sin. So rejoice in all things. We rejoice. So you rejoice in all of that folly. You just don't participate. I don't care who it is. I don't care if it's mama, daddy, brothers, sisters, daughters, son. You don't participate in the folly. Let them. It is a vile thing. I'm telling you. It is vile. That's why the nation is so consumed. If you ask most people what Valentine's Day is about, its originality, its origin, some of the things. In Rome, what they would do, what they call on Valentine's Day, it was not as what we think of. It's all of the same ritualistic pagan form. What they would do, everyone just say a congregation of people, they would put their names in a hat. And then once they put their names in a hat, then people would draw a name out of that hat. You may draw John Boy, you may draw Betty Sue. But when you drew the name, there was an encounter, a sexual activity. It made no difference if a man drew a man's hat name or a woman drew a woman's name. They had to interact. They had to love each other. That's what those filthy Romans were. That happened on the 15th of the month. And then on the 14th, it was this cubic. That philosophy came about that one ripped the man's heart out and he ate it. And so that's why they give you the hearts and the heart shapes and all of that. We are so damn ignorant. And we'll go out and spend. Can you imagine the money we made yesterday on some silly flowers?
Well, here it rained, so.
Oh, that didn't stop anything, Holt. You think that stopped anything?
Well, all the people out on the corners, they got
That so didn't stop it. You think that they're the only one. Hold up. You think they're the only one that sell flowers? It's a multi-billion-dollar industry, a cult. Every
I
year.
Know. Yes, I do know that.
They went to the stores and everywhere. They bought candy. All right, my hope. May Yavrak you enrich
your life.
Shalom, shalom.
Shalom.
You're listening to Shemach Yisrael, Raah Dawid Yisrayah sitting here. This is Raah Dawid sitting here live tonight. We want to hear from you. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. Yah's going to send the delusions. He's going to take them down to hell, Yisrayah. You just stand faithful and true in the Torah of Yah. I want to talk a little tonight. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. To you that have received the email today concerning what I wanted to speak on tonight, I want to speak from a particular verse in Torah, is Bereshit, and I want this teaching, this fellowship tonight to be entitled Red, R-E-D, Esav. Who is he? You have so many different analogies and so many prophecies, and everyone on every street corner in every major city. You got one group on this corner that doesn't give a damn about the group on the corner two blocks over. You got another group three blocks over. They don't give a damn about either one of those, and neither there is no solidarity at all. They're all seeking their own. They all have the fabulous truth, and they are a bunch of jackasses. I want to read this from Bereshit, Genesis chapter 25, verse 25. You cannot define words by your unlearned ignorance. You cannot do it. You can create a culture of expression within your social setting, as we call it, slang or words that endear you in your communication with others. But when there's an established etymology of a word, you cannot alter that. So it makes no difference what it means to you. It has an origin, an originality. And in that, we find what we call the definitive. It is defined. It cannot be altered. It is established. It is settled. And you cannot alter that. You can try, but it doesn't alter the significance or the picture or the aura that it induced to the mind when one hears it. What it began here in Bereshit, Genesis chapter 25, verse 25. It talks about the birth of two. Ya'achob, and one that was called Esau. It says, the Rishon, the first one, he came out, he was red. He was Atzmoni. He was Atmoni, which that word derives from the word Adum. So you got those that call themselves Caucasians say, you can understand, we were the first people. You got those, a group that says, that all whites are the sons of Esau. Well, hell, there is no white man, no more than there is a black man. That terminology is a word created for a superior culture that one believes, that one possesses, that one could take this grandizing type of hubris arrogance and say, I'm white. It doesn't mean a damn thing to ya. It's a vile thing. And so you got these competing factions. You got those of the dark hue skin to say, well, all white people are of the nature of Esau. Okay, we're going to examine this word, Atzmoni. It implies that is the Hebraic expression. Bereshit, Genesis chapter 25, verse 25. It is Atzmoni, Atzmoni. It implies red and ruddy. That is the context of that. It says that he had hair all over as a hairy garment. And they call, or there was a reciting or a kara, they call his name Hashim Esav. That's his name, Esav. He was red, he was ruddy, he was Atmoni. And that word Atmoni comes from the root word of Adom, to be red, to be ruddy. So does that imply what we as a people or our unlearned knowledge has taught us? I want to define this word out some of the, what we will call the most recognized scholarly researcher of linguistics, all right? And I want to begin with an assortment of what we will call historical guides of study. I want to begin there, all right? I want to give us a brief history of the words ruddy. Ruddy. I want to use in this first analogy, there's a dictionary called Dictionary.com. You can find it, dictionary.com. This ruddy, it is an adjective. This is what it implies now. It is one of or having, it is a fresh, healthy, lively color, or a liveliness to one, a ruddy complex, red or reddish. It is a British slang word that means damned. This man was a ruddy fool. It means that one is damned. That's what it implies. One of the most recognizable dictionaries that we as that is common with most people, it is called the Merriam-Webster. Now we're looking at the origin of the word ruddy. I will define it by Torah. We're going to define it by the masteries or the mastery of the skill of linguistics and etymology. I'm going to define it and show you the master of all words by Torah, what Yah says it means. So Merriam-Webster says the origin of the words ruddy, Middle English, ruda, from the Old English, ruden, from rudu, redness, akin to the Old English, reeds, red. It implies, if we use it as a synonym, it means to be florid, blooming, glowing. It means to be full-blooded. It means to be red and rosy. That's what it means. It means liveliness in one's countenance, one's presence. That is what it implies. In the medical dictionary, when we define the word red or ruddy, it implies having a healthy reddish color. Having a healthy reddish color, usually resulting from an outdoor life, that there is life, the flowing of the blood through the cells of one's face, it gives a great radiance of fullness of life in one's face. Well, the most prestigious Oxford Dictionary, it says the word ruddy, of a person's face, having a healthy red color, a cheerful pipe-smoking man of ruddy complexion. It is used as a euphemism for the words bloody. I'm defining this according to the intellectual escapades of the foolish of the world. I'm going to define it as Yah defines it. Wikipedia says ruddy. Also, it is called floret, a reddish, rosy, crimson color, close to a red that to rose, also a brownish shade of ruddy, called ruddy brown, is often referred to simply as ruddy when it is referring to an animal. A pinkish tone of ruddy called ruddy pink is often referred to simply as ruddy when described the colors of the cheek of some Caucasians. That's what the words it defines in Wikipedia. And there are those that will say, you see that? The first that came out was ruddy, and he was. Let's read that again, because I want to make sure that we understand, and we're going to examine this word, ruddy, red. Atzmoni. I want to examine it by the definitive of the Hebraic expression. Hallelujah. Again, it says in Bereshit, Genesis chapter 25, verse 25, and the Rishon, or the first one that came out, he was Atzmoni, he was red. He was ruddy. He was hairy. And they call his name Esav. Harry. He was red. He was from Adam. He was from the first man. He had life, was lively. He had strength, vivaciousness in him. Well, I don't believe that's man. Well, let's examine the words Atmoni according to Torah and see if it defines it that way. See if that's so. I want you that have joined me, let us examine in First Samuel chapter 16, verse 11. I want to begin reading. This is when Shamuliah was sent unto Bethlehem. He was sent unto Yeshua for one purpose, to anoint the messenger, the king, the Melech of Yisrael. And the word the Torah speaks here, First Shamuliah, Samuel 16:11, it says, and Shamuliah said unto Yeshua, hear all your being, your children, those that have been birth of you. And Yeshua says, there remain yet the youngest. And behold, he keeps the stone. He is the watcher of the sheep. And Shemuel said to Yeshua, send and fetch him. He said, for we will not even sabah, we will not even sit down till he come. He knew he was the one. He knew. Shemuliah 16:12. And Yeshua, he sent and brought him in. Look at the characteristics of David. Now he was ruddy. Was David a white man? Black man? Man of the dark hue? What kind of man was he? Does not the Torah say that Esav Bereshit 25:20? He was Atmoni. He was red. He was ruddy. The same word for red, Atmoni, Hebraic, is Atmoni here with David. David was ruddy. He was reddish of the darkness of skin complexion. And with all of a Yafeth, he had a beautiful countenance, his ayin, his expression. And he was tough to look at. Yasser, arise, I want you to moshach, to smear, to pour, to anoint this one, for this is the messenger. He is the one. Let us examine the words in Shemuliah chapter 16, verse 12. When they brought in David, it says he was ruddy. Now that is the English expression of the words atmoni. Atmoni, atmoni. He was ruddy. He was red. He was of a darkish red complexion. His skin glowed with great brightness of beauty. Was not Esau ruddy? Was he red? Was David a son of Esau? Was he of the same birthright? Did he come? Was he born out of the nation of Yisrayah? He used the same expression. It says that he was ruddy. It says that his countenance, he was ruddy. Now there these fools will try to debate that. Listen. I have the 1611 facsimile KJV. The 1611. And the words are identical in the original 1611. Nothing has changed. It uses the same content. He was ruddy. Now, does this word ruddy or atzmoni, red, does it apply in the same degree as it with Esav? Or is there is a dimension that is different? I ask you the question. You're listening to Shemak Yisrayah, Reach Dawid Yisrayah. Sitting here live, you can call the telephone number. It's area code 843-658-6222. Someone give me a call and let me know if we have someone listening. Yah says, arise, go anoint him, a ruddy man. You tell me he is of the lineage of Esav? He is of the same characteristics in the physical visual perception of him. It says the first one came out, he was atmoni. And David, when David came in, he was ruddy. That's what it says. How do we define ruddy? Can I move a little farther? There's only two accounts? That's what these fools will say. Some of these immature retards always posting things on our YouTube account. They assault and insult me, but it doesn't bother me. I say, this is your last one, okay? They're little boys. That's all they are. It says again in 1 Shemuliah 16:12, and he sent, and he brought in David. He was atmoni. He was ruddy. And with all he had a yafef, he was beautiful, his countenance. So was Esau, was he grotesque, with deformity? Was he ugly? It is the same adjective, same superlative that expressed the demeanor of David. It expressed the very demeanor of Esau. So which one was he? Was he grotesque, unappealing? Is that what it means? Can I move on the Father? I shall. It says in verse 13 of 1 Shemuliah, then Shemuliah took the horn of the oil. He took the shemim. And he anointed him in the midst of his ark. And the ruach of Yah came upon David. From that day forward, so Shemuliah rose up. And he went unto Ramah, unto the high place, the hill, to seek Almighty Yah. We're examining the words ruddy, atmoni. Was David, his lineage, was it of the house of Esav? Or was he of the house of Yisrael? Was his lineage associated with the same characteristics of Esau. He was red, and you can call it red Ruddy. It is defined, or it is expressed in the Hebraic language, Atmoni, A-D-M-O-N-E-E, Atmoni. That's how it is expressed, A-D-M-O-N-E-E, Atmoni. It is defined. It is defined as this characteristic. That's what the word Atmoni implies. We find two accounts. We find this in Bereshit, and here in Shemuel, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11, that the same superlative, the same adjective is used to express the freshness, the health, the beauty. That's what it is. And so those that are unlearned and unstable, they wrench that, they wrestle with that, and they contort it and turn it and make it what they want to. They're deceivers and they are damn liars. But that's not enough. Well, I'll tell you what, my friends. Can I share a little more? I tell you what. Let us look at 1 Shemuel, chapter 17, and verse 42. When David, when he rose in the anointed power of Yah, he said, who is this dog that spit this vile venom upon Yisrayah? 1 Samuel 17. Verse 42, this beast called Goliath, it says this in 1 Samuel 17:42, that the words were so precise that even Yah, even the prophet, knew by the Ruach of Yah what was said. It says in 1 Samuel 17:42, and when the Philistine or the Philistine, they looked about, and they saw David. He had this bazaar. He had this disdain. He held him in great contempt. He said, who is this little beast? He said he had disdain for him. And these are the words of this beast. For he is but yet a little boy, a Naha. He is yet a youth. And he says, and he is Ruddy. And he is Atmoni. And he is Yafeth. His countenance is beautiful. You see how even the prophet, his words express how David looked, David's. And yet out of that expression of the prophet of Yah, the Nobi, this unclean Philistine, he spoke that David was Atmoni, not Ruddy, not Red. Esav was Atmoni. And these liars have twisted the truth of Yah. The dirty white ones, the dirty black ones, the liars. The damn Mexicans and all. I don't care if you don't like me. I deal with truth. I don't deal with emotionalism. You're listening to Shemach Yisrayah Reach. David Yisrayah sitting here live. Anyone listening, send me an email. Give me a call. Area code 843-658-6222. I want to hear from someone tonight. All right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to hear from you. If this is not making any sense, then tell me, Reach, you need to sit down. You're destroying the beauty of Torah. Challenge me, my friend. I have no problem with that. I'm a warrior. This vile Philistine said that David was at when he was ready. Yah says that Esav, he was at when he was red. He was ready. Shabbat shalom. Who's calling? Where are you calling from?
Shalom, Pastor. That this is Yesiah out of Boise, Idaho.
Yes, my friend. How are you doing?
I'm doing well.
Well.
I have a quick question for you.
Yes.
My issue, this is kind of off the subject of what you've been talking about.
That's all right.
That's so good. I feel kind of sad for interrupting. But she's been making a lot of our clothing, and she wanted to know if it was okay. She had an old costume that she used. If it was okay to take that fabric to make something else with it, or should that go in the trash?
Well, you know, what kind of costume? If there's something that's been dedicated to the works of darkness, you know, you can go to Walmart. I don't know if you have them there. I'm quite sure you do. You go to Walmart, you get dollar material. Most of the suits I wear, all of my clothing, my Israel makes with for me material from $1 a yard to $4 or $5 a yard. Cheap. I would not, you know, if it's a costume, if it's something that she has bought, she has worn, it's an attire for you or her, that's all right. But if it's something that is repugnant and has no, it doesn't represent the beauty of Yah, I will not do it. I will not do it. I will not.
Okay.
I will not take something that is a costume. When I'm thinking of a costume, I'm thinking of something that is, you know, pagan, Christmas, a hallow, and all of that.
What?
Damn it. Huh?
Sorry.
Or some kind of, oh.
Something that was used for pagan, it was the old Halloween costume.
No, I would not use that. I would throw it in the trash. I would throw it in the trash. I will not utilize that for any service. I will not use that. It has been dedicated unto the works of darkness. I will not use that. He will grant that. Come on, go to Walmart. You'll be surprised. I don't even, when I go to Walmart or Yalmart, as my Lucipora would say it, I tend to go back to the, here in the South where we are, where my issue goes, they have quite a bit of material, clothing material you can buy. It used to be a dollar yards. You could buy $8. I would buy 8 yards for a hat, for a shirt, and a pair of slacks that she would make for me. And that's all it would cost. And now you can't find that. Now it's like $2 a yard. So the same suit I was paying $8 for, it cost me $20 now. But I can't, you can't buy decent, I can't buy a suit of clothing that fit me out of the stores for no $20. Can't find it.
And there's nothing against wearing the color red, is there?
I'm sorry now? Who said that?
I said, is there anything,
Who said, let me ask you a question. Do you ever go out and look at the beauty of flowers and all the beautiful colors of flowers and everything? Yah has colors in his spectrum that our eyes cannot even fathom. This is what the religious whore has taught us. No, a woman should not wear anything. I don't care what it is, whether it's red, black, green, blue. If she wearing anything that is so that accent her sensuality, then something is wrong. She can wear some old dirty jeans and draw attention. If they're too tight on her ass, she got on things that her titties are out. You can see her nipples. These whores out here, they don't wear red to draw attention. No, it's all right. It's all right to wear red. It's all right. It's all right. No, you didn't disrupt the lesson. That's why we're here. You don't say you disrupt the lesson, because that's what I said. I said, Cole, you're not going to disrupt what I'm saying. So we have no problem with that. All right? All right. Yabarak. Shalom, shalom. All right. Cole from... I were there that where it is cold. I know it is. We're going to have some cold weather here tonight. Maybe a little snow tomorrow. I kind of hope so for the children. They're always asking me, Raah Dawid, the little one calling me, Papi, when is the snow? We're going to have snow. And when I tell them when the forecast is calling for a little snow, they stay on me. Papa, you said snow was coming. I'm just giving you the forecast. You're listening to Shamah Yisrayah Raah Dawid Shamah Yisrayah live. We are discussing from Torah the writings of Bereshit chapter 25, the words Atzmoni 25, the one that came out. We have proceeded in this process for there in Shamuel Yad chapter 16, 1 Samuel 16, when the Nobi was sent to anoint David, it says that when he came into the prison, that the first thing that this Nobi realized that he was that money, he was red and ruddy. And with this vile Philistine, in the 17th chapter of the same writings, verse 42, when he saw David, he had bazaar, he had disdain for him. Why? For he was but Nacha, he was a youth, and he called him Ruddy. Now, I know what the fools will say. They're going to define it in their convoluted, twisted definition of words. That's what these liars are going to do. But he called him Ruddy. So I ask you, was David of the lineage of Esau or Abraham? Which one? Out of the lineage of Esau or out of the lineage of Yaakov, Israel? The characteristics of Esau are the same with David. He calls him at money. Let me show you a picture of the excellence of Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. How Shlomo paints Yahshua here in Shira HaShirim, Psalms of Solomon. I want to show you the excellence of Yahshua HaMashiach. Not this damn false, twisted Jesus you talk about. It says here in Shir HaShirim, Psalms of Shlomo, the singing, the voice of Shlomo, Psalms of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 9. I want to hear from you. You will not interrupt me. The telephone number is Erico 843-658-6222. You're listening to Shemach Yisrayah, Raah Dawid sitting here live. I may continue this next week. We will see how my physical nature is. But there, I want to teach also from the book of Obadiah, because there are many that have construed what Obadiah was saying. And I want to show you what he was saying concerning the Edomites, all right? But the Psalm of Shlomo, Psalm of Solomon, it says in chapter 5, verse 9, it says, why is your dude great, greater than another's dude? O you fairest among women, why's your beauty and your splendor of your covetous not like others? He says, why is your dote greater than another dote? And you have placed us under an oath. You have caused my heart to be smitten and overtaken. Listen to what he says here. He says, my beloved, she, he says, is sach. Well, I know what white folks say when they see that. It says, my beloved is white. So does that mean that Yahshua, that's what, that this is what this implies? That Yahshua is white? Or does it mean just what it means when it says, sach? You're so dazzling and you have such a beauty of brightness and glow that accentuate your beauty. And also it says, and atmoni and ruddy. So the beauty of Yahshua, is it expressed as Esav or out of the expression of Yaakov, Yisrael? You cannot diminish the power of the definitive. You're going to take Bereshit 25:25. You must carry the same line of interpretation here with the same word. You have these liars today, Yisrael. These perverters of Yah's Torah, they're corrupt, they're wicked. Is that what it says? This is an expression of the excellence, the beauty of Yahshua HaMashiach. Psalm of Solomon 5:10, my beloved is white. Sach. Now that's not what the Hebraic word was. White, it was sack. You have a beautiful glow that is so rousing and clear. And not only that, you are unruddy. Atmoni. Was this then the woman that was a daughter of the Edomites that Shlomo loved? Well, we will find out as we read. He says, you are the Dagal, the chiefest among the 10,000. Now look, now this is Yahshua here. His rush, verse 11, his head is the most fine gold. His locks are, his kitzvusa. His locks are bushy, they are tal-tal, they are wavy, they have this beautiful hair. And it says, and black as a raven. So is that how Yahshua HaMashiach look? Was he ruddy? Was his expression ruddy? We have this juvenile approach to Torah. That men, and these unlearned men, they're ignorant. They're making those that pursue them twofold the children of hell. We're dealing with one word, ruddy. You can call and debate it. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. Is this the characteristic of Yahshua HaMashiach, that he is ruddy? That's the beauty of the psalm. That's the beauty of Shlomo. His head is as fine gold and bushy, and there are those that of the dark hue will say, see, he was black. His hair was black as a raven. It was Shachkor, beautiful, jetty black. Most people cannot even tell you what a raven looks like. He speaks of the description of a man's allure, his color, his complexion. So is he ruddy? The same word ruddy is used in Psalm of Solomon 5:11. My beloved, as she responds to him, my beloved, he is sach. You're so dazzling. You're so fine. As an Ishaw would say to an Ish man, you're so fine. And when she sees him, her eyes glow with it because he's dazzling. His beauty is so bright. And she say, you are atzmoni. You are, your skin is just so lively. That's what the word ruddy implies. That's what it is. You can define it any way you want to. You are a liar and you are wrong. I'm not concerned what these juveniles say to me. I don't want them to corrupt your mind and your passion for Yah Yisrayah. You must hate Esa. That's not what the Torah teach. I have one to post on our YouTube channel. In Devarim 23:7, that word should be Syrian. Well, I look at the 1611, and it says Edomite. It doesn't say Assyrian. That's what it says in the facsimile of the 1611 KJV. And I guarantee you, you don't even have one. You will not find your damn Jesus there either. He's not there. Can I proceed? Someone call me. Let me know if I can go look, Father. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. Someone give me a call quickly. And let me know if I can go look, Father. Because I want to make sure that you that are there, that this has some meaning to you. Hallelujah. Dibarim. I want to read from there. Can I go look, Father, Yisrael? Is it all right? Give me a call. Send me an email. Area code 843-658-6222. Area code 843-658-6222. Someone give me a call quickly. I want to hear from you. The Edomites. Should Yaakov hate the Edomites? Yah calls them his brother. That's what the Torah says. You can twist it all you want to, you pervert of hell. That's what you're a pervert. Shabbat Shalom, who's calling? Where are you calling from?
Hello, David. God bless
you. All right, my friend. Yabrach, how are you doing?
Right, how are you doing?
All right. I'm trying to bring this thing down to simplicity.
That's a beautiful message. You got on. I like that.
Yes, sir. I'm going to bring out this atmoni. You see, it's what it is. And these men are liars. They are contorters of truth. The wicked men. Yah's going to kill them all. They out there hollering on the street corner that he's going to kill Esau. He's going to kill all these dogs. Because you know that in the book where Yah would rid the nation of these liars and pseudo false ones, he's going to kill them all. They will try to answer that with a twisted concept, but they can't answer it because it's written in the book, my Ark.
The Israelites is out there talking about it all the time.
Yeah, but they're not Yisraelites. They're not the Zerah of Yisrayah. They're false, young, twisted boys. They don't even know what truth is. They're arrogant. They're brazen. They're full of lies. They're so ignorant. It doesn't take much for someone to convince them. It is not that they haven't experienced with what they say. They're just repeating and regurgitating what they've heard and that have been driven into their minds. That's all, my friend.
Well, they're terrible. They're out there. There's so much against the white man. You have to get away from them.
Yeah, it's what they're saying is just insane. It's stupid. These are just immature individuals. They have no knowledge. And they are redundantly using the same thing. You got a group here on this corner. You got a group three blocks away. And they don't even recognize each other. They won't even sit down and break bread with each other.
Oh, yeah, they're terrible, man. They're terrible. It's sad, but it's true. They're out there. Esau this and Esau that.
Yeah. And they don't know. These are young, and most of them are young Nacha. They're youth. They're inexperienced. And they're so venerable in their anger. They, I mean, you see it on them, boy. They are angry and they're ready to.
They're angry.
Oh, man. What are you talking about?
It's like a gang, you know. They're going to hack somebody.
I know, man. They pack strong now. They're not going out there one or two. You got some of these boys out there that talking about they're trying to win everybody. I've seen cats out there that are just one of them. And then the midst of a rout of people spitting on them and everything. These fellas, you see 10, 20 of them together.
Yeah, they come strong.
Oh, yeah, they come strong, man. And they're ready to throw down, too.
There's some coming out of the garb on them, I mean, everything.
You know? Oh, man, they got their pilasteries and everything. Just silly.
Yeah.
That's all it is. And I have no problem saying that. I'm not fearful of them. They know about me. There are many of these little groups around. They know about me. They know about me. They don't like me.
Oh, yeah. What should they do?
They don't like me, though.
They don't like true business.
No, they don't. They don't love Yah. They love their damn Jesus.
Yes.
The vile Jesus.
They love their Jesus, don't they?
Yeah, that's all they love.
And their Lord and their God.
Yeah, and you know, like I said, I got the original. I have the facsimile 1611 KJV. You can't find the name Jesus in there nowhere. It's not there. This is a facsimile that I'm holding up of the original KJV, King James 1611. This is the facsimile. The word facsimile means the original writing, the original speech, and everything. It's not like these that have been translated and changed. This is the facsimile of the 1611 KJV. Same writing. You will never find the name Jesus in there. It's not to be found. You cannot even find it in here.
Yeah. So, it's, you know, we've been through so much so long. I think we're fall for anything. But when the truth comes, we can't take it.
Yeah, they hate truth. They don't want truth.
No, they just hate it. I mean, they hate his name.
Sure they do.
It's in their level. They won't take the time out to research.
But listen, Zaki, but and all of them have Hebrew names, though.
Yeah, right.
And they serve a Latin vile Jesus, an English God, a dog. A dog. I'm not fitful to say that. They serve a damn dog. A lie.
Well, I had one more question to me. So, how you know Hebrew? You know, we lost our language. I said, we lost our language. I said, he did not lose his name.
And I guarantee the fellow who said that he got a Hebrew name.
Yeah, he do.
I know he does. They're so stupid and immature, I guarantee you. They take on a Hebrew name and call on their Lord God Jesus.
I mean, when they say that Jesus said.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness, man. You're going to come out for that. But, I ain't fighting these brothers because I don't have time for them. I'm trying to save myself.
Me either. I don't care. Just go on, man. You can call on your Lord Jesus. Your pagan lies is all right with me.
Right. You don't do you. Because you know what everybody else do. I'm going to get the truth.
Absolutely.
I'm not going to sell it.
No, I'm not going to sell it either.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
We'll be here for you tomorrow.
I know you will, my friend.
I talk to you about everything else.
All right.
Ticket to start.
All right, Yavrock, my friend. Toda. That's our precious Ark Davis out there in California, Los Angeles. I had someone to say to me that here in Devarim 23, verse 7, when Yah speaks to Yisrael, now let begin here, Devarim 23, verse 1. Now we must understand what this is all about. Those that are able to go into the Beit of Almighty Yah, into the house, to offer up the offerings, to bring the sin offerings, to come into the gathering. If you read in verse 1 of Devarim 23:1, it tells you those that cannot. It says in verse 2, a bastard shall not enter into the congregation of Yah, even unto the 10th generation. He's talking about a mamzer. Those that have mixed bloodline. That's what he was talking about. Born of incest. Now, if that's the case, the vast majority of those that declare that they're Hebrew Yisraelite, that whereby there's been a great integration of every kind of ethnicity of people that have taken the women, and that's why you have so many children of the mulatta of every color among that people of the diaspora. So are they bastards? So he's talking about in verse 3, the Ammonites and the Moabite. He says they shall not enter into the congregation of Yah, even unto the 10th generation. He said they shall not enter into the congregation of Yah forever. Do you hear that? The Amorites and the Moabites. They shall never enter into Yah's house. Then he goes on to tell us, you know, those that cannot. This is what this is all about. Who can enter into the house of Yah? And then he says unto Moshe. Moshe says here. He tells us, Yah commands us here in Devarim 23, verse 5, verse 3, verse 7. He says, you shall not abhor, you shall not ta'ab. That's what he says. You shall not regard as abominable. You shall not despise. You shall not hate. When the word ta'ab, it says that when you regard someone as abominable, it means that they are despicable. You hate them, you despise them. They, you know, they're unclean ethically and they're unclean morally. You treat them as herent. You treat them as such vile, grotesque. But that's what Yah command. How can one say they know Yah and twist this? He said, you should not hate an Edomite. So you tell me that this should be Syrians or the Syrian. And we know that if it was a Syrian, the tribe or the sons of Asher, or that it's somewhat related to that. So you should not hate an Edomite, for he is your brother. Who was he talking to here? He was talking to Yisrael. How was a Syrian his brother? He's talking to Yaakov. He's talking to Yisrael. He said, you should not hate an Edomite. He said, you shall not hate an Edomite, the sons of Edom. What? He said, because he is your brother, you shall not hate the Egyptians. Because you were a stranger, he used the word gear. You were a stranger in their land. You were a stranger in their land. He said, you shall not even hate an Edomite. And then he says this, the children of the Egyptians, the children of Esau, the children that are begotten. He uses the word begotten or yalad. Those that have come through to the birth chamber, to the process, they have been born. He says, those that are begotten of them shall. He used the word enter, which is bo. They come in. They pass in. They can come in. They shall come enter in into the Chahal, the congregation of Yah, he says, in the third generation. That's what Yah says. He said, even the seed of Esau can come into Yah's congregation in the third generation. And how many generations have we passed from the bondage of Mizraim? This is a stupid, damn, twisted generation. Well, that's for the Syrians. Well, okay. Let that be for the Syrians. Is this for the Syrians too? Here in Devarim chapter 2, what Yah says. This is what Yah says now. Devarim chapter 2. I want to begin in verse 1. You're listening to Shemak Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Yisrayah sitting here live. I want to hear from you. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. It says here in the Torah, Devarim, chapter 2, verse 1. I want you to hear this. When Yah commands Yisrayah, as when they deal with the Edomites, he said, I don't want you to touch one of them. Leave them alone. That's for me. Look what Yah says in Devarim, chapter 2, verse 1. It says, then we turn and we took our journey into the Mitzvah, into the wilderness. By the way, now, if the word here is red, isn't it? But it's Suf. It is not Adomi, by the Red Sea, the Yam, by the Red Sea. As Yah had spoke to me, as Moshe cries out. And we circle, listen to what he said. He said, and we circle Mount Seir. Well, what is Seir for? He said, we circle it many days. Hairy and shaggy. Is that not the heritage of Esau? Sure it is. Yaakov blessed both. Yitzchak blessed both. He blessed both. Yaakov and Esau. Yah has blessed them both. Look what Yah says. Verse 2, and Yah spoke to me, Moshe, saying, he said, boy, you have circled this mountain long enough. Turn northward. I want you to go to Sophon. Go north. And Yah Savah, he commanded the people, saying, you are to pass through the coast of Yoak. These damn wicked liars. He said, you are to pass through the coast of your ark. Now you can't get by, you damn liar. Say, this is Syrians. You're a damn liar. Again, he says, you shall pass through the coast of your brother, your ark, the children of Esau, which dwell in mountain or the Mount Seir. Is that the mount of the Syrians? Or is that the place of Esau dwelling? Sure it is. You see how these liars contort? Or they say in Devarim, chapter 23, verse 7, it says that's Syrians. And so here in chapter 2, Yah says you shall pass through the coast of your ark, the children of Esau. Does he call them his brother? Someone give me a call and repudiate me if I'm reading incorrectly. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. I want to read from Devarim out of the 1611 KJV. I want to show you what it says. All right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The 1611 KJV, it says here, and Devarim chapter 2. verse 4. Does it say the same thing? Devarim chapter 2, verse 4. It says this. And command thou the people, saying, ye are to pass through the coast of your brethren, the children of Esau, which dwell in the land of Seir. And they shall be afraid of you. He said, I want you to take good heed, thee to your Seleucus, therefore. That's how it says it in that writing. So is this the Syrians? You Hebrews that post on our website or our YouTube, is this Syrians too? See, you can't get by that. You can say what you want to. Devarim chapter 2 verse 4. Someone give me a call. Here we go. 843-658-6222. Yah says to Moshe, and Yah Savah, he commanded the people, saying, you are to pass through the coast of your ark, your brother and your brother, the children of Esav, which dwell in Seir, the mount, the heritage of Esau. And he said, they're going to be afraid. They're going to have this Yahreh. They're going to fear you. He said, I want you to take Tav, Heave. I want you to watch yourself, Shema, guard to yourself, therefore. Why, Yah? He tells them, Gara, meddle not. Don't stir up nothing. Don't contend with them. Don't create no friction. He said, meddle not with them. For I will not give you their land, no, not so much as a foot's breadth. Is that Esau or is that the Syrians? You damn fools. He said, I will not give you as much as a foot's breadth, because I've given Mount Seir to Esau for a possession. He said, that's what I've given him. I've given him a possession. Yah says in Devarim 2:6, you shall buy meat of them for money that you may eat. You shall also buy water of them for money that you may drink. For Yah your Bar has blessed you in all the works of your hand, Yisrayah. He yada, you're walking through this great wilderness. These 40 years, Yah your Bar has been with you, and you have like nothing. He says, listen now, in verse 8, when you pass by from your ark, he calls them their brethren, their brother, the children of Esau. Is that Syrians? Which dwell in Seir. He said, through the way of the plains of Elath or Eluth, and from Etzion, Geba, from Etzion, we turn and pass the way of the wilderness of Moab. He said, I want you to even spare the Amorites and the Moabites as well, even though they cannot come into the congregation of Yah. Does that imply, so Devarim 2 in the 1611 KJV, you tell me it says the same thing? You KJV thumpers and that love the KJV, and King James was a black man? Come on. Verse 8, what does it say? This is what it says in verse 8. And when we pass by from our brethren, the children of Esau, which dwell in Seir, through the way of the plain of Eleth and Izan Geber, we've turned and passed by the way of the wilderness of Moab. Same writings. Same expression. So are we to hate Esau? Yah commands us to love our enemies. You don't do them wrong. No, they're not going to do you wrong. I'm not worried about any man doing me wrong. I'm not worried about any man getting physical with me. I don't worry about that. You don't have to say anything. You don't have to worry about them doing that. These are liars. They're corrupting Yah's word, Yisrayah. Hallelujah. They are corrupting the word of Almighty Yah. They're liars and they're corrupt. I want to teach from Obadiah 1, because there are those that believe, they don't even understand what Obadiah the prophet is saying. And I can't do it tonight. It's too much. But I want to teach from that. I want to teach that whole chapter. Yah's will, I will do it next week. Hallelujah. So as we, as a nation of people, Yisrael, should we hate Esau? Is the word ruddy red? Does it apply the same definitive there in the in Shemuel Yah as it did in Bereshit 25:25? Can I show you an instruction that Yah gives unto all Yisrael? Can I show you? It says this in Weira in the Torah. This is the whole house of Yisrael. Yah says in Leviticus chapter 19:33, Yah says, and if a stranger, what is a stranger? There are those out there on the corners, they're so cold and ruthless. They won't even allow a stranger. And the word stranger is a gear. Those that are foreign to Yisrael, those that cohabitate or they inhabit the same dwelling or the place, or someone that is a temporary inhabitant of one's country. Yah says to Yisrael, and if a stranger, a gear, if he go or sojourn, he abides, and he dwells with you, and he remains with you in peace. And if it continue, he give you a surety, he labors with you, he works the fields with you. He say, even a stranger, and these damn wicked beasts out of hell, he say, if a stranger sojourns with you in your land, he said, you shall not, Yana, you shall not oppress him. You don't oppress any man. You don't treat him violently. You don't maltreat the man or vex him. You don't do him wrong. In verse 34, but he said, but the stranger or that one that is temporary there that dwells with you shall be as one that has been Ezrah, born as a native of all right, born among you. And he said, and you shall love him as you love yourself. For you were strangers in the land of Mizraim. I am Yah, your Abba. Is that applicable today? Or is that just a facetious lie? Is that something new, or has it always been? Someone give me a call quickly. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. And our precious Aksafonia, we greet you all there in Cincinnati in Yahshua's mighty name. They're calling maybe for some snow here. And we are hoping that we get a little snow for the children. They are excited. And they're always asking me, hey, Papi, we're going to get some snow. We will find out. Yahs will be done. We don't want no 5 inches or foot. I mean, no 1 foot or 12 inches. We simply want a little bit for the children to run out and to act silly. Hallelujah. And for me to go out with them and to be as silly as they are. What a beautiful blessing that will be. Arach Chayil Benamin, we greet you, my Ach. You and your family, your children, your Isha, Yoshua's mighty name there in Arkansas, the riches of Yah rests upon you. Hallelujah. He said the message is tough. Keep it flowing. Shalom, shalom. Yes, it is truth. And we need to understand that these liars are corrupting many. And because they know that the simple believe anything. You can tell someone simple any damn thing, they buy it. Now let's match it up with what Torah says. You don't entreat no man wrong. I don't care who he is. He said you should love your stranger as yourself. So a gear is one here in Weira, Leviticus 19:13. You're listening to Shemak Yisrael, Raah Dawid Shamah Yisrayah, sitting here live. Someone give me a call quickly. The telephone number is area code 843-658-6222. to. We want to hear from you tonight, Yisrayah. Give us a call. Hallelujah. Let us look at this. You see, it's the same Torah for the stranger as it is for Yisrayah. Has nothing changed, Yisrayah, in these liars, these corruptors. They usually take advantage of the silly and the simple. That's what they do, Yisrayah. It's not of Yah. It's not of Yah. He said, you should not, Yirah 19, verse 34, Yah says here in the book, but the stranger, the gay, the one that inhabit the land temporarily, is a foreign to Yisrayah that dwells. I know what these fools will say. When we get to our land, then we can do that. This is a simple generation. You know that people that raise hell with me say that, look at this false Esau preacher here in America. And I would say, where do you live? And these damn fools live in America themselves. Damn America. Hallelujah. Yah's going to restore his people to the land, and not these wicked, ignorant people that get a little group, take them, and there's such a dichotomy between them. And it won't be long that little group split. Why? Because I've experienced that here. I speak from wisdom and experience. But the stranger that dwells, that lives, that's good, that abides with you, he shall be to you as one Ezra. That's born among you. He should be as you treat a true Yisraelite. He said, you shall love him as you love yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Mizraim. That's what Yah commands us. And for us to operate any other way, it is a repugnant law of hell. No, Yah did not say in Devarim 23:7 to love the Syrians. He said, don't hate the Edomite. Don't hate Edomi. That's what he means. That's what he says. And he also, I guess he doesn't mean don't hate the Misra, the Egyptians, huh? That's what he meant. You don't hate them. But Yah say, love your enemy. You don't create any dissension. You don't even create no fight with him. Just let him go. No, he's not going to fight you, because when a man sees strength in another man's eye, he's not going to mess with him. He may take a coward way out, but he's not going to mess with him. He's not going to mess with him. And that's the truth, Yisrayah. He is not going to mess with him. Does the words at Moni, is it the same here in Bereshit 25:25, the first came out, he was at Moni? Does it imply the same thing when Shemuel saw David? He says that he was ruddy. Shemuel, 1 Samuel 16:12. When he brought him in, the first thing that he noticed that he was ruddy. Does it imply the same thing? When this vile Goliath saw him, he saw David, he said he had disdain for him because he was young, and he noticed that he was ruddy. And the very beauty of Yahshua HaMashiach, the head, the Rish of Shalom, as this beautiful Ish-shaw speaks to him. She saw that, and even her beauty, and saw that this ruddiness or this atmoni, that his brightness was brighter than the fairest. So is that implying the same thing? Or is the concept, or is this whole book a lie? So is this 16:11 right? Is it right? Did they make a mistake? So if they made a mistake, how do you believe the book? How many other mistakes they made? If they made a mistake with the word Syrian, how many other mistakes did they make? And you believe it? I won't believe it, because I know in the book there is no mistakes. None! Because these were Kodash men. As the Ruach moved upon them, they wrote. And even through this fragmented language of English, that's why Yah has given men time to understand. No, you don't have to speak Hebrew fluently, but you can understand enough about it that you can grasp the knowledge of it. These men are ignorant men. They know not the way of Yah. They know not the power of Yah. And that's the truth, Yisrayah. So if they made a mistake, throw the damn book out. Throw the KJV out. It's not worth its weight in nothing. It is either all factual and truth, no mistake made. And if you count that as a mistake, if it was not Esav, if it was meant to be Syrians, then the whole book is a lie. That's it. A little leaven leaveth the whole lot. It is the small infraction that destroys it. And who told these men what documents they have of the case of Kurim that they know that the word was Syrian? It is so stupid. These are young boys and they're ignorant. And those that are simple of mind, they buy it. They fall down to this wicked interpretation. Hallelujah. Yah raise up the true messengers, the prophets, the Novi'im. Raise up the mighty men, the strong men of tenacity, the warriors. He's going to bring it down, Yisrayah. You're listening to Shemak Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Yisrayah, sitting here live. I'm not going to start on the Obadiah this week. Yah's will, I will do it next week. And teach on that Ezekiel Yeremiah. He sits in 1 week, and I do appreciate that. He's very knowledgeable, and his teachings and they're very inspiring, very motivational, and gives us all strength. And I appreciate that more than anything, because I know I'm not that crazy. I cannot do this by myself. It takes everyone in this community, every Ahot, every Ak, every child, for this to grow and to move. And you that are friends and our listeners and you that's, it takes all of that. And that's the truth. You're listening to Shemak Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Shamah sitting here live. We want to hear from you. Someone give us a call. There's a telephone number. It's area code 843-658-6222. So many fall off from me. I understand that. Even in the secular sense, when I was in the world, I watch men that say that they were my friend. I've never betrayed a friend. I've never. People will betray you because they just said you said something or you said something to offend them. I've said things to offend my wife. My wife has said things to offend me. I won't leave my wife. I will not leave my wife because of that. I made my wife cry. In 36 years of marriage almost, you think I've made her cry? But that doesn't mean I will leave my Esau. And we leave each other with some of the most damnable, immature, stupid thing. That those, oh, you're my pastor. Shut up, woman. You're full of a Jezebel spirit. You want someone to promote you and make you think that you're something. You're full of wickedness, woman. Oh, you're my pastor. And when the messengers say, you're wicked, woman. Oh, no, no, no. A liar. And they get offended. They're so easily offended. Oh, they aren't a cult. So what? Your husband called you a fat Jezebel. You call your husband a wicked, two-timing adulterous dog. So what? You call me what you want to. You're listening to Shemak Yisrayah, Raah Dawid Shamah, sitting alive. I feel wonderful tonight. I'm alive. Listen, Yisrayah. We have a few of you all listening tonight. I need your help tonight. I really do. I'm not a beggar. But there is an essential piece of equipment that we need. I need that desperately. I really do. It costs $324. That's not a lot of money. We don't have the funds here. I need it. I really do. I was somewhat skeptical about asking, but we have enough of you all listening tonight. Someone, please, I ask you to help me. Even if you can't send a whole 300, few of you all can send 100 or 50, send me enough to get what I need, all right? It's a piece of equipment that I need when I travel. It is not a computer. I'll tell you when I get it, all right? And if you or someone wants to purchase it and send it to us, I will send you the link. You email me, I will send you the link, and you send it to me. I will send you exactly what it is. If it's on Amazon.com, one piece costs $299, and the other piece costs $14. It's about $325, $315. It's shipped free, and I desperately need that, all right? So if y'all moves on your heart, someone, if this is a blessing, There are many of you that have been fed greatly by this broadcast. You know you are. And you've never sent one dime. You don't even have any conscience. You don't even have no fear of Yah. There's no way I can sit and listen to a messenger like this that blesses my home, revive me, and not never send one damn dime. It's a sign of great wickedness. It's wrong. There are you that waits to listen to this broadcast. You tune in. You will not send one damn brown penny. And T.D. Jakes can get people to send millions that he can live in a multi-million dollar home, drive $250,000 cars, wear $1,000 suits, $1,500 suits. My clothes are made by my Israel. There are those that have been here, they know how I live. They see it. I have no fancy lifestyle. I don't want no fancy life. I don't even want the burdens of that. It's enough in this little small shack we have. So I don't desire that. I have no riches, no source of income. I work, and we utilize the funds that we're able to, that come in to take care of those small necessities we have here. And that's it. But I do need that $300. If Yah moves on your hearts, I'm not begging. But I know that there are you that can do it. You've never sent a dime. I know that there are those that if they had it, they would send it. I know that's a fact. I know that. And there are those that will take money for crypto dollar to walk on and they will run. A man like Eddie Long, a faggot. I saw the YouTube clip. This woman came to him and it was a stack of $100 bills like that. You know it was at least $10,000 or more, $20,000. She put it. No, these were not ones of 20. You can go Google that on YouTube and see it. And know that he's raped these boys. And he is a man that speaks simple truth to bless your house. And there are you that will not even send one dime, one penny. You're an extortioner. There are liars that have said they will help and strengthen. Men that they had talked, they were full of talk, but they were liars. And they don't see that they are liars and they have vowed to Yah. And they think that they're going to get by with it. So someone or a group of you all send a gift to help me get that because we need it. Listen, Yah commands us in the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians. This is what Shaul says. In other words, he's telling us our relationship, who we should be around and how we should do it. He says on 1 Corinthians 5:9, I write unto you a letter not to company with fornicators. Yet not altogether with fornicators of this world, or with covetous or extortioners. Those that are that rob and take. And that's what some of y'all are. You're just simply extortioners. You take, you don't even help. You won't even do anything. With idolaters or them that must need to go, or you must need to go out of the world. So what is an extortioner? Here you're blessed and you get richly fed here. And your heart is not, your heart is so callous that you won't even help. Help us. Send your tithes and your offerings here. And if you think that when Yah says that you're cursed, oh, he means that you do the research on the word curse and see those things that bring about the curse, have they changed? When a man lay with another man, is he cursed, or a woman with a woman? Sure, he has not done away with his tithes and gifts and his offerings to be brought into his storehouse. It's one thing if you visit us here, you can eat well. You will always eat well. We always take care of the people. We always. So if you will help us, help me. You can write. You want to email me. I will send you the link and you can purchase it and send it here. I will appreciate it, Yisrael, with great appreciation. And that is the honest truth. I will appreciate it much. You're listening to Shemak Yisrael, Reak Dawid Yisrael, sitting here live. We want to hear from you. Someone give us a call. Erico 843-658-6222. $300 is not much. It's a lot to us here. But if you can help us, you can purchase that. you can send a portion of that. Do that, Yisrayah. And we'll appreciate it. We had, as a sister, her name is Sister Debbie, and she sends a gift every week. And she says, I want to send more. And Yah knows I want to send more. And he will grant that. There's a precious Akhtayon, Yah. And that he sends a wonderful offering each month. He said, you know, this is what I want to send. I say, my Ak, I tell you what you send is a such great blessing, a such riches. Ak Mikaya, Mikayala and Sophonia, they're always the riches. Ak Yaakov there in Florida, Jacksonville, and there in Texas, they're kind and faithful to the work chamber. We need you that are listening to help as well. Come on, Yisrayah. Give us a hand. Help us. It costs for all of this. It costs. People write all the time for booklets and for some of our material. People will write, send me everything you got. They will not send one dime. Come on. You should be courteous enough and kind. That if the poster, you know, if we sent you everything we have, it will cost $40, $50 just to send it to you. It would be so much. And they will not send a dime. They will not send a penny. And we send 3 free booklets to anyone. Well, after that, send an offering. Come on. Just don't send enough for the postage. Send an offering. Total cost. We had to buy a brand new hard drive for our printer. It costs money. And it takes from the small budget we have here to keep the community running. So send an offering. Send a gift, all right? You're listening to Shemak Yisrael Riyah. Dawid Yisrael sending her life. Hallelujah. Let's hear the song, all right?
This is my desire. Yes.
You give us a call, area code 843-658-6222. Oh yes, someone give us a call.
With all I have,
with all I have
in me,
hallelujah,
I give you praise.
Give you praise.
All that I adore is in you.
I like that.
Yeah, I give you my heart.
I give you my heart.
I give you my soul.
I give you everything.
You're
so
every
kind.
Breath that I take, every moment I'm awake,
you made me.
Yeah, I have your way.
I give you
me.
All. I give you all. Oh, I give.
This is my desire, Yahweh.
I give my desire. Everything to you,
Yahweh.
I want
all
of
my heart. I worship you.
With
all I have within me.
All I have within me.
All that I adore.
Oh, I give.
It's in you.
Oh, I give you praise, yeah.
Yeah, I give you my heart.
I give you everything.
I give you my soul.
Oh, I give you love.
I live for you alone.
Everything.
The moment I'm away.
You command, yeah.
Yeah, I have your way.
Oh, I give it to you,
yeah.
Oh, I give it all.
I live for you.
I live for you alone.
Well, give you everything.
The moment I'm away.
I give you my land, my life is yours. Oh,
I give you my soul. I live for you.
I live.
Let me rest.
Now
I live.
Oh,
I have no way.
Give
me
your
oh. I give you everything,
every breath,
That's all right. As you all want to feel that. Come on, I want to hear some more of that.
Yahweh.
Oh, my. Oh, this is my desire. Someone give us a call. 843-658-6222.
Whoa. I give you praise.
Hallelujah.
All that I adore.
Whoa. Oh, I adore
is
you.
In you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I give you my heart.
I give you everything.
I give you my soul.
I have nothing but what you has given me. Everything I am. Oh, yes, you are all. Nothing young you made me.
Oh,
you made my mind known. You made me mad. Oh, it all belongs to you. Oh, yes. Yes, it does, yeah, it all. Oh, it all belongs to you, oh, God.
I'll
keep nothing, I shall leave. I shall leave with nothing, yeah. I brought nothing into this world. I brought nothing, yeah. Oh, it's you that I would take. I would take my
faith.
It all belongs to you. That's all right. I guess I'll sing a few minutes. Hallelujah. Someone give us a call. Here we go. 843-658-6222. Oh, everything I have,
I own nothing. It's in you. Yeah, I give you my heart.
Oh,
my soul.
I give everything to you.
Every breath.
Oh.
Hallelujah. Yeah, have your way. Yeah, I give you my heart, my soul.
Yeah.
I live for you.
There's nothing that I have.
Every breath.
You make me. Yeah, you make me. Yeah.
Yeah, I have your way.
I live not myself. You made me. Yeah. You give me life. You give me
something.
You give me everything that you do.
Oh,
you give me life. You give me breath again. Oh, I owe it all to you. Oh, my dear. Oh, everything I do.
I live for you alone.
I owe it all. Everything,
yeah, oh, have your way.
I owe it all to you, yeah.
In me,
have your way, yeah. That's all right. You're listening to Shemach Yisrayah, Reach Dawid Yisrayah, sitting here live. We want to hear from you, Yisrayah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have an email, Raah Dawid Shamah, thanks for the note. Much appreciation. You're right on course, but not everyone on my mailing list view it the way we do. Sometimes I think it's a spiritual form of ad, so I will keep plugging away. Glad you responded. All right, my friend. Hallelujah. Well, Yah's just going to save his nation, his people. Hallelujah. He's going to restore his nation, his people. Grant unto them the riches of the knowledge of Yahshua HaMashiach. I'm not going to cast his pearls before the swines or the dogs. He that is wise wins the nephesh. I'm not pouring out his truth just to anyone. You can, but I will not. Hallelujah. They turn, they rent, they spit on it. That's what they do. I see it all the time. I just don't talk about Yah and cast his pearls before this devilish, damnable, wicked world. Hallelujah. Now, what must be declared? I show you what must be declared, and it's among this rebellious house of Yisrael. Hallelujah. There's only one thing, one truth that must be declared unto the nation of Yisrael. Hallelujah. And these wicked, this wicked generation of vile men. And I will show you. There's an everlasting Ulam Via teaching. It's in Giliana Revelation, chapter 14, verse 6. And I saw another Melech from the midst of Hashemayim having the everlasting message, Bezurach. The Bezurach, the everlasting message to declare to them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred, and to every tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, first of all, fear Yah. We don't teach people how to Yare Yah. We talk this slathery, false, damn twisted talk. And that's why they don't respond. That's what the message should be. Fear Yah and give honor to him. Why? For thou his judgment is come. For thou was his judgment is come. And we must worship him that made the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. And then after that, you're going to hear the voice that Bavel has fallen. Hallelujah. That's the truth. That's the message to be declared. You're not going to save anyone. All you're preaching, all that you haven't garnered, no one. You're listening to Shemach Yisrael, Raah Dawid Yisrayah, sitting here live. Been a beautiful night tonight. You all that have listened tonight have joined us. I hope everything went well. I'm looking at the screen here whereby I know that there's a live feed. Everything is froze. So I don't know if it's going through. I haven't heard from anyone. I haven't heard from Aksimion. So undoubtedly it must be going through. So we appreciate your calls, you that have called, your words of encouragement. Again, I say to you, I petition you all to, you that have joined us, send an offering, a gift to help me get this. It's a small piece of equipment, but I do need it. I don't have the funds to do it. You can send it to the PayPal account, and I can do it directly from there. If Yah grants you the funds to do it, I will send you the link, and you can do it for me. Hallelujah. It will be a great blessing as I travel. I can use this. I need it. I really do, because it's somewhat difficult when you try to travel and to set a meeting up, and you don't have everything to facilitate that. So be a blessing and help someone that is in need, that the poor has this. The poor will have this message preached to them. I've enjoyed you all tonight, Yisrael. Yah, it's that time. So what we're going to say to you all, Yah's riches rest upon you all. May he strengthen you all. You want to be with us on the Shabbat. There's a profound truth that shall come forth. You that receive the newsletter or the mail or the letter this yesterday or today, you want to be with us. May Yah grant you strength and wisdom in all you do in Yahshua's mighty name. Until we hear from you, we say to you all on the Shabbat, Shabbat Shalom, Yisrael.